are you, man?
I'm okay. How are you? As you can see, I'm getting older. I can't see you guys unless I look this way. Okay. Who's who? Because I don't know.
I'm the guy that you've been messaging. I'm Joey. This is Roger. I don't know where he is on your screen, but he's above me.
Yeah, he's right in the middle. You're right to my right, and I'm to the left.
Oh, okay.
Perfect. Roger, do you want to explain how the program goes?
Well, yeah, we can continuously record. So we are just gonna get right into the interview. And as far as like any edits or anything like that, we can send you a copy and you can let us know. Hey, you know, take this out, and so you can have just a approval over the finished product. So if it feels clunky or it's like, oh, I misspoke here, or we took something out of another podcast where the guest was like, oh, I didn't want that to be public knowledge or something like that, you know?
I appreciate that. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay.
So we have little 30-minute segments that we'll do, and then we'll take, like a 20-second, 30-second break? Right?
Well, we don't even need to do that in this case. Usually on the on the PC, we're recording with a certain app, but with this one, we can just continuously record. So we're good to go.
Cool. All right. We'll get right into it then. So, and it's totally free form, Jason. I like to avoid scripted questions because that kind of leads us in a direction that wouldn't be possible if you were just kind of telling the story on your own. So that's what I want to do. I want to start with you in the Gracie Academy taking the Gracie Challenge. Where did that come from? How did that even get in your mind?
I'm actually really glad that you asked that question. I've answered it a bunch of times to people, but it's very relevant today. It's one of those weird twists of fate. So I'll be a little nebulous with the story at first, but so the other day I woke up middle of the night, YouTube was running, and there was a video on there's a channel called, I think it's called Golden Bell Training, and the gent was doing a special on Steven Seagal, it was called The Three Times Steven Seagal Ran from a Fight. I don't know if you guys were aware of this, but the real reason I went out to LA, I didn't even know about the Gracies. I went out because in the early 90s, Steven Seagal in Black Belt Magazine released an open challenge to anybody who wanted to go to his dojo and fight him. Be prepared to fight to the death, yada yada. So I did. A friend of mine who wanted to go out there with me, we went and we stayed for 6 months. The very first morning that I woke, I went to his dojo and I answered the challenge, written with magazine copy, everything. And I attended every class, morning and night class, for 6 months and waited. That was 92 during the riots. And I waited. And Matsuka Harawa, who was his teacher, that's the same guy that you see him beating up in the movies all the time. And if you've ever seen the movie Above the Law, the school that I went to was actually the school they filmed the scene in Above the Law, the very beginning. And I went there every day. So in this guy's page, he talked about how nobody ever went and answered that challenge, which I think is funny because I was there every day, twice a day, for 6 months, and yet Steven Seagal got to be a trainer in the UFC, a guy who's never been in a fight. So I'd like to take this moment to say, I hope you guys can get a hold of him and make him answer for it. That being said, the 6 months that I was out there eagerly awaiting his answer, a friend of mine out here, a man named Dan Marlboro, knew a lot. He was a friend that I did karate with. And he told me about the Gracies. And at the time, I had no idea that this thing even existed. So he told me about it, and I said, I was running out of money anyway. I said, I got to go do something. I figured I'm going to go in there and make a little bit of quick money. And so I called up the school, and I spoke to Rorion. And that was another class story. Rorion's a class act. I called him up and I said, you know, I'd like to do this. You know, we talked a bit about it. He says, what's your okay, because he said we could bet, or we could just spar, or we could do a lot of things. He says, if you want to bet, I says, I'd like to bet $600. So about the day before we left to go do the fight in the Torrance dojo, he calls me, and he goes, hey, I was thinking, let's not bet any money. And I went, all right. So right in my head, I'm thinking, oh, they're afraid, right? Dumb kid. And after the fight, I asked him, I said, hey, he goes, hey, you made $600. I go, how do you figure? I says, why did you call off the bet? And he goes, $500 is a bet. $1,000 is a bet. He goes, $600 is rent. And I looked at him like, oh, man, thank you. Thanks for thinking of me. But that's how I got there, was I actually was out there to answer Seagal's challenge. Of course, he never showed. But from that, I wanted to rematch because, again, being young and dumb, not realizing I stepped into a dynasty of no-holds-barred fighters, I'm thinking I got to beat this guy, you know, because at that time I'd never lost. And I kept bothering. And some time had gone by. I had to move back. I was out in Hollywood for about seven and a half months. And when I came back, I still persisted. I had some people who were actually going to sponsor my trip out there to do the fight again. And when I called him the last time, he said, hey, we got this deal. And he told me about the UFC. He says, how'd you like to try for your rematch there? Sure. And that's how it went. And I appreciate, I thank the Gracies very much for the chance they gave me. In particular, I thank Art Davey, who was a student of Hoyler's. Art Davey, if you guys, as you must know, was part and parcel of creating the UFC. But a very, very distinguished, very, a man of great integrity. Great integrity. He did a lot to help my career. I appreciate those guys.
Yeah, I just spoke to Art Davies the other day about being on the show, so we might have him on here pretty soon as well.
Well, so, please do. Please do. Yeah. He's a wealth of history and knowledge. Wonderful.
Yeah, we're definitely trying. And anytime he wants to come on, we'll have him on. Let's go back into the room with the green mat.
Right.
At the time that fight started, did you know anything about jiu-jitsu at all, or was this the first time you see or hear jiu-jitsu?
I'd done judo, and to the degree that we did jiu-jitsu in the style of kung fu that I did, most people don't know the word jiu-jitsu actually comes from Chinese. Jiu-jitsu is the original, and it was practiced, but it was not practiced, kind of like the difference between what jiu-jitsu and judo was like. It was not practiced as a preeminent form, like just stay on the ground. It was just part of the repertoire, so that, you know, you'd see an armbar, but not guys who were pulling armbars from, you know, every known position, just as a staple.
So you knew some techniques. When the fight started, did you know Royce's strategy was going to be like manage the distance, close the distance, or was that completely unknown?
No, I didn't, and I had an idea because I had seen there was one Black Belt magazine article where they had shown clips of. So I got the idea. Okay, these guys are ground fighters, but I had no idea how rooted in principles that they were. The principles that they have are, I mean, Rorion Gracie devised this to be, basically, he devised it not for sport, you know, for no holds barred. And I think it would have been, Royce's success would have gone a lot longer had they not implemented rules, because things like referees and rounds is a big thing, because it changes your strategy. You know, you're dealing with a style that was devised for ultimate combat. And to have somebody be able to step in and interfere with your game plan at the end of a round or in the middle of the action, that changes things a lot. So that the gist of their style is, it's organic. It's made for the wild. You know, it's made for real situations. Once you make it into a sport, well, you're giving other people control over your ability to perform your style.
You know, and this is a point that we hit on so much on this show, is that even MMA, like today, the general public thinks this is what a context, anything about the referee, the time frame that the fight goes, the rule set, like no striking the back of the head, no knees on the ground, it limits the fight to such a small element that it's crazy to say, but it's almost more simplistic now because of the rule set. Whereas when you were fighting, when Royce was fighting, it was almost like this kind of conversation. It can go anywhere that it goes, and however long it takes is what it's going to take. And that's much different than what we see in the UFC today.
Well, especially when you consider, they kept true to their challenge, which is they would fight anybody of any size. And I mean, you see, like Hoyce, the one time I think he fought a sumo wrestler in Japan. That's a big man. You have to accept that your strategy is going to be more simplistic, and it will rely on attrition. So you're all the time fighting to keep what you got and being patient. And patience can be any amount of time to be in one position because you can't give it up. You're aiming for something very specific. And to have a rule element come in and debunk your strategy, it's like in boxing, back fists in boxing are illegal for whatever reason. I don't know, because it's silly to me. It's the least effective punch. And referees get to use their discretion. Some guys will throw a back fist, they don't say anything. But some fighters, if they're using a back fist, they'll step in and harass them. Why? Back fist is nothing. It's no big deal. But it's something they use to control the outcome of a fight. And so anytime that they can, do anything to manipulate the strategy, they will. I mean, that's the nature of sport.
Yeah, the rule set is based around what looks the best or what's most entertaining, what drives the fight on the hardest, not let's find out who the actual best fighter is.
A good example is when I went to Japan, I had trained, and even my entire career before UFC, I had trained as a traditional martial artist, so we adopted similar ethics. You know, if you're thinking in terms of a fight, your strategy is this, this, and this. And when I went to Japan, it's so convoluted with what they used to do in pancreas that you get used to not fighting naturally, so it's not organic, and they take you out of your game. Like, you bust your guts to take top position, you were on the bottom, and you're sitting there and you're losing your breath, and you finally scramble to get out and you're on top, and as soon as you do that, the ref stands you up. So now you're doubly tired and you gotta stand up. I mean, that's too much control for a ref to have over two guys who are busting their butts to fight. And in UFC, I mean, it's the amount of interference, it's marginal, but it still matters. In particular, just the fact that, okay, I finally got this position, round ends. Oh, are you kidding me? Now you're gassed, you gotta come out and do round two. That's the nature of it. But I think of all the styles that existed at that time, that was the organic time. Because these days, everybody does jiu-jitsu, everybody does wrestling, everybody does boxing, kickboxing, Thai boxing. You have to, because that's what everybody does. In those days, jiu-jitsu guys were jiu-jitsu guys, Thai boxers were Thai boxers, and they wanted to see who's going to win. So it was organic. Now, that it's homogenized. Everybody trains everything. And that's the only, really, that's the only way that the Brazilian system was ever beaten, because everybody had to learn Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in order to compete against it. The nature of the sport didn't do it. It was the nature of the styles had to evolve into one homogenous style. So there's really no style, per se. There are the athletes who make their own. I mean, I've seen these guys who go in the ring, one of these capoeira guys, I think they call him the samurai. Guy can do a backflip in a fight like I can throw a jab. That's crazy, but the super athletes now.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're going to get into pancreas. I definitely want to get into that in just a second. Just to take it, roll it back just a second here. In the fight with Royce, in the challenge match, the first fight, when in that fight did you feel like something is up? Like there's something to this? Or, things aren't going away?
It's kind of funny. I knew I was in great shape. I was training hard for something anyway, and this was one of those this was just a step along the way, or so I thought. And when I realized that the entire MO was to be smothered on the ground, so my experience in judo was traditional, you know, can you get out of hold downs, can you hold a guy down for 30 seconds or whatever it was at the time, but not to know that these people were, that was their MO, you're going down and we're staying down, we're not coming up till this is done. That is when I realized, when the first fight was done, Rorion had asked me, do you think there was something you could have done different? And then he asked me, would you like to try it again? And the moment he asked me, I knew, no, I'm out of my element. Because this is the odds of me. I mean, when he shot, I threw, you know, Brazilian punches. no pun intended. I threw a bunch of punches, and he was so quick on the entry that nothing mattered. And I mean, I was cutting up. I was cutting right and left, and nothing mattered. And once you hit the ground, you realize it's like, this is going to be a long day, and he's going to be able to consistently get me here versus me consistently keeping up. I could tell, no way.
You know, this is super interesting because this fight has almost morphed its way into the teaching of closing the distance. That when we teach that technique and we reference this fight, because the fight is very traditional when you guys start to fight, right? There's a couple of kicks both ways, some striking, standing, and then when you decide to engage, you're 100% committed to the attack. Well, Hoist is 100% committed to managing the distance and then closing the distance. So it's competing interests. And it's just interesting that at some point, because of the caliber of attack, this became part of the teaching methodology. And I have to say that of all of those challenge matches, you seem to give Hoist the most problem. There were a couple of times like you were in a triangle. It looks like you landed a punch. Did you land that left on Hoist when he transitioned to the triangle?
I tell this story. People didn't know this, but before that fight, I did a form of Qigong, iron fist. And for a year, I was wrapping my fists into a cement wall 1,000 times a day. And when I threw that punch through the guard, I thought, I finally got him. And I hit him really well. His head was planted on the mat, and I hit him really well. And I was kind of the impression that his legs were so long that there was like a pocket, kind of harder to close the pocket for him, because I'm not a big guy. If I was a bigger guy, I think it would have been easier to close it up and just choke me right out. But when I threw it through, that sucked me right in, and I went, oh, that was a mistake. But that was the only thing that I really landed that had any effect, because he was on the ground. He really couldn't move. But it didn't matter, because once that punch went through, he cinched it up and rolled me in. The rest was history.
What changed from that point where the fight ended and Rorion asked if you wanted to try it again, to you deciding, no, I'm going to disregard that experience and try it again? What, in your estimation, did you discover or do it between the first and second fight that you felt, now I will answer?
My judo teacher was a traditionalist, so I had a lot of teachers. I did kung fu, taekwondo, kempo, I did a lot of things. But my judo teacher was a traditionalist, and so I trained for traditional sport judo. And so, as you know, you're down on the ground for, you know, only so long, and they're going to stand you up. I didn't really anticipate that there was a dynasty of people whose sole MO, I'd never seen it, but I felt it that day, realizing this is his game, is to be here. And I know that it's, you know, just through bare knuckle fights that I'd done, guys had taken me down before, but they were limited. And knowing that, because I'd worked with wrestlers, and wrestlers were always a nightmare for me, knowing that this guy had all the bag of tricks, and his base was so, see, that's the other thing. Hoist is very subtle. You don't feel him when he's on you. He's not oppressive. He's like empty jacket. He's like that. And so knowing that he was able to just keep me there for that length of time, I knew that I wasn't prepared, but I knew how to prepare, was that I had to devote myself just to the ground. And my original intention was, I figured I could devote to the ground enough to be able to escape the ground. So I spent a long time training with a lot of, because back in the day, judo guys, they didn't want to hear this. They thought we were doing cockfighting, you know, crazy. But I devoted a long time with a lot of really good judoka to perfect a ground game. And they liked to do it too, because a lot of the guys, they would train for what the judo guys were doing for groundwork was minimal. But when I came along and I said, look, I'm doing this thing and I need to do this, they liked the idea that they get to break up what they were doing because they were training throws, which is ironic because I love throws. I didn't really, you know, I wasn't wanting to do the ground game, but realizing this is the obviously the wave of the future, although I didn't see the future, but Orion did. You know, they knew that the rest of the world would see this and go, 100 years ago when we had bare-knuckle boxing, no rules-ish, he knew it would repeat itself, and it went around the globe. As much influence as any religion. You know, there's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu in every town, just about every state, every country, everywhere on the planet. It's huge.
Absolutely. What exactly was it that made you want to continue to fight after that? Because you went on to fight many, many times in different organizations. And again in the UFC. Why continue?
It's just martial artists. I'm a martial artist at heart, artist too, not necessarily martialist. I don't, there was a time when I really didn't care for professional fighting because it's brutal. I mean, it's just, you know, you're fighting guys, sometimes you're fighting. And if I was equipped the way, you know, I would have needed a system that equipped me to fight guys much bigger than me. But like, I remember fighting Bob Stein, the guy punched me once, nearly killed me. 265, 185, that's crazy. But of course, what was I doing trying to stand up with this guy? I saw him knocking guys out with lead punches. I should have known better, right? But the indomitable spirit part is, especially at that time, I'd never lost. So that was my first loss. And it was hard to grow. And I believed in myself that I could do this, I could do this. Of course, afterwards, when I came back, I'd seen this dynasty. You know, I'd finally seen the in-action tapes and seen fights in Brazil. Like, oh my God, I had no idea this was going on in the world. You know, and I see it, and I'm like, you know. And a lot of the judo guys, it was funny, the judo guys that I trained with, they looked at these fights and they said, oh, they don't show me anything on the mat. And I looked at them like, are you serious? Because for them, you know, this is done this way, this is done this way, this is good form, that's bad form. And, you know, you have to break everybody out of the idea of traditional form is traditional form, and this is what goes on in a real fight. I mean, you know, it's like,
You know, in the past, I've heard you say that at some point, the UFC became almost like a bar brawl, more brawling and less technical. When do you think that was?
I think when they started to bring, when they started to bring in animus, you know what I mean, people talking smack and that kind of thing, I was never a fan of any of that type of hype. I'm like in boxing, I'm a fan of the old days when fighters like Joe Louis and Rocky Marciano put a suit on and would talk about their strategies and talk about, you know, I know my opponent's got a good left hook and I'm going to this, I'm going to that. This relegating it to, you know, people talking bad, people cursing, people, you know, all that ugliness, that started to really make me kind of ill. And the types like, and no offense to Tank Abbott, but because he's obviously a formidable fighter. But a little decorum, please. I wanted it to be something more in line with the ethics that we learn from, which is courtesy, dignity, you know. And it's hard because you're fighting. I mean, you're fighting for a living. And some guys, that's the only way they can motivate themselves is they have to build up a little bit of animosity to do it. And, you know, I hate that, but that's the nature of the beast.
At least the decorum side, I could look at Pancras at least had more of that aspect, more martial arts kind of personality than the UFC, or was it just entirely a sportive kind of deal?
Well, I think, kind of back to the UFC, I think it's because the culture in this country was, you know, we don't have a homogenized culture like in Japan. Everything has a certain kaizen to it. We don't have a homogenized culture, and especially at an event like that, like a NASCAR, you know, it's people let themselves go. So like UFC 1, I'd never been to an event that big in my life for anything. And to the way that people reacted, it was just, you know, throwing beer cans full of beer and spitting, and it just, you know, calling the fighters atrocious names because they didn't know, like when they saw Ken tap Pat Smith with a heel hook, they lost their minds simply because Pat was from, you know, and they turned into animals. I'm like, whoa, you know, you'd think you'd appreciate that these guys are out there risking their lives to do this, but humans just, they're funny. They're funny. They don't think about it. And of course, a lot has changed, but it's still a rowdy mentality. I think especially because a lot of the people who have that kind of rowdy demeanor, they're not competing. So they're coming. They're kind of living vicariously through us, you know. So they get to act the part without actually living it, and that's unfortunate. But the way it is.
A lot of times, the loudest voice is the last person that you should listen to for sure.
Yeah.
Especially in the, jumping over into Pancras, where in the story did that fall? This was after the UFC 1994?
No, 1993. I got there in 1994, but I had met Ken and Bob Shamrock in UFC 1, and the story goes, we made a joke about it once, but I don't want to do it because I'm not trying to be disrespectful to Ken, but when I met him, I had already fought Royce, and when I met him, him and Bob were scouting for fighters to fight for his org, Lion's Den, in Japan. So they told me about it, and they said, we'll send you some material so you can see what it's about. And so they were very nice. Bob was really nice. He liked me right away. When he likes somebody, he treats them like they're his kid, and you feel it right away. You appreciate it. So I said, hey, watch out for this guy. He's got a really good rear naked choke. And Ken's attitude, because of where he'd been, I mean, it stands to reason, especially after working with him, because, oh my God. But he goes, ain't no 175 pound karate guy gonna choke me up. And I went, oh, okay. And so he didn't take it serious. So that by the time he got there, he realized, oh, this is something different. So that was where they met me, and my advice to him that actually came to fruition, I think, helped him to respect me as far as, because Bob told me, he says, he told you. And then it happened, you know. Obviously, his opinion is worth something. So they endeared themselves to me, and they offered me the deal to go in Japan. And as I could see the UFC growing into, you know, no holds barred, I look at some of those guys, I'm so glad. I imagine in those days, if I'd have fought Gerard Gordeaux, that guy would have murdered me. I was just a kid knowing nothing. As a result of a lot of the people that I met, one of which was Carlos Valente, who knew that I had potential, but he knew that I was in over my head. So he spent time, and I think he spent time with me at the behest of Hickson to give me some tools that could carry me, because there were some real animals that could have killed me. And I, looking back, lucky to be alive.
So you used techniques that Carlos taught you in Pancras?
I didn't have to rely as much on the principles because Pancras being what it was entertainment in the sense of, like, flow jiu-jitsu, you know what I mean? They didn't want guys just going in there and mauling in the beginning. It was supposed to be artistic. So, you know, we were programmed with the axiom, 30% power, 70% technique. And the only time they reversed that equation when it was, if you're going to do NHB, then it was opposite. It was 70% power, 30% technique. But for the Pancras, you were encouraged to do, like, the way Kung Fu looks. Connect the moves, transitions, constant movement, and make the fight exciting as best you could. So we trained that way so that we could make the fights that way, because it was based on pro wrestling. I don't know if you guys know about the 100 years ago tournament that happened. So, like, back in the 1800s when we had no holds barred back then, the system became like it is now. They were so efficient and brutal that people were getting whacked. And so they, in Japan, and Teddy Roosevelt had something to do with this, they came to an agreement that they were going to have a tournament. And if the Aiki Jiu-Jitsu Judo slash people, the Jiu-Jitsu people, if they won, then the MMA guys had to be theater. So pro wrestling became made out of that. And then anything that was competitive in a Jiu-Jitsu realm that wasn't work was Judo and so on. But that's actually how pro wrestling became 100 years ago. So at the same time, no bare-knuckle boxing anymore. No more, what they used to do was pro wrestling was real. Then they made it theater. So we get to that point now when Funaki and Suzuki came out with Pancras, the idea was to do pro wrestling, but real, all shoot. And so they said it's not going to go over unless people see the technique and not just the raw. How's that?
Yeah. So when Boss came along, just throwing 100% power, was that unexpected, or was that inappropriate as far as Pancras was concerned?
No, that was actually perfectly organic for what they wanted, and that's, I think, the thing that Funaki respected out of him, which made them really want him to be the Dutch representative, was that he was a Thai boxer through and through. And he was not, there was nothing tentative about him. You know, it was really raw. When I first saw him, I admired him greatly. And I still do to this day, because he's not one of those people that he retired and then he does something else. He's a martial artist to the end. And the system that he created, that he teaches, I think is one of the best refinements for overall integration. You know, when you're going to say, you know, you look at somebody who's going to do Pure Land Jiu-Jitsu like Royce, doesn't have to concentrate on stand-up. He's going to time the shot. But you look at the first people who came out of that organic situation who made a full system. This is my stand-up and this is my ground game. The power aspect was just because of his intensity. He was so intense and literal. So if you say this is in the rules, okay, then I do it. Like we had an unspoken rule. You can hit in the ground, but don't if you want to make this thing roll. But every once in a while, certain fights, guys would hit each other. And it just depended on what was going on with those two fighters or what was going on with one of those fighters. But in general, we could hit anytime we wanted. We just didn't. We wanted the jiu-jitsu to be a flowing, transitional, something fun, something, take a chance, do something, do something worth writing about, like that.
You had a lot of battles in Pancras. You did well in UFC. Did well, despite the finishes that you performed well in all of those organizations. Out of all those fights, who would you say gave you, win or lose, gave you the most challenge? They were the toughest person that you fought.
I think Royce and Boss Rutten were the greatest champions that I ever felt against for certain reasons. And the one is this, you know, you guys know, it's layered. You see two guys doing the same thing, and it looks like, well, he's doing that, and he's doing that. but then you roll with them and you like, oh my God, I never felt anything like this before. Like I had a student, this is 25 years ago, I had a student of mine who went out to California, so he stopped in and he got to roll with Hicks and Gracie. And he came back and like all people who are inexperienced, he goes, I did really good up until he hooked me. He goes, and he looks at me and I look at him with a, you know, that look like, you poor boy. You know, he was a man, he was actually older than me. And he goes, you think he was just working with me? I go, he could tell your atomic weight when you walked in the door. Yeah, of course he was just working with you. But the perception, you never know, you know, you never really know. I heard Hoyt say it once, he said it in an interesting way. He says, you know, some people, they're building a rocket, you know, to get to, I think he said, like, get to the moon. And, you know, and then they're trying to catch another person who's already built a rocket that's going to Mars. You know, you don't know until you're there, and you can't tell by looking. You only know by the feel, and then all of a sudden you realize something else is going on in this. And I would say, Hoist for, and there is actually one other, I fought him when he was very, he was young. But I knew by the first time I fought with him that he was going to be special was Chris Lytle. Chris Lytle had a certain type of, same type of thing, like empty jacket, no energy, but you couldn't do much with him. In fact, I don't think the kid was ever tapped to this day. And I had rolled one time with Pseudo Genki. He was another one. Didn't matter what you did to that kid, I think it would just fold in half and he would look at you. You know, so this different challenges with different people, but with the Hoist and Boss Rudin both have this certain quality. Part of it's the indomitable spirit, and part of it is there's an intelligence that it's there, but you're not sure what it is they're focusing on. You just know it's there, like they're above you and you know it. Nothing you can do about it.
And you fought a lot of great guys, like Funaki. You actually knee-barred Funaki. They're, you know, this caliber of guys. What the difference between Funaki's technique, which is fantastic, and, you know, the guys that were poised and these type of guys? Did it feel different?
I can tell you one thing that I know through eons of study, which is the jiu-jitsu system is still at its core. It is a traditional form, which is based on, I don't know how to say this without, so Aikido is a good example, because the jiu-jitsu that's in Aikido, people, you know, have this misconception about what Aikido is. It's wrestling. It's the wrestling that fighters were prone to use during a sword fight. So the techniques that you see people doing in the practice, and no Aikido people fight, right? The rendering that we do in Aikido, it's stylized for just that reason. It's just fun. The moves that you're doing in Aikido are because of swords, because of weapons. So most of those moves wouldn't have been even devised had it not been for two guys fighting over a sword. So like in Aikido, they'll train like, grab my wrist. And they go, well, why would you even hold on? Why would you just punch the guy? Well, if there's a sword involved and you grab my wrist, you're not going to let go of my wrist. You have to keep my wrist held because I got a sword in it. The MO for it is the same for all traditional martial arts, which is you're fighting the dead zone, i.e. passing the guard. So the system is based on, that system hasn't changed in, even in Thai boxing, even in boxing. The entries to the side, the basic things that you're trying to do. Whereas guys like Funaki, they grew a system out of, they grew a superfluous system. All the things they do are effective, but they're really geared towards entertainment. So they don't have a base self-defense system. They really grew up being entertainers in martial arts. So you get a lot of habits that are not conducive to if you're going to fight in a situation. So whatever, you know, whatever you consider to be a basic in your sphere, basics win fights. So you see, like in judo is a good example. When I first started judo, when I was really young, I wanted to learn big throws. And my teachers always tell me, you got to learn the basics. You got to learn position. You got to learn basic foot sweeps that set up the big throws. No, I just want to do that big throw. And they're like, don't you get it? You cannot do those big throws unless you do these basics. So Funaki was a pro wrestler since he was 15. So he went right into entertainment. Everything he does is effective, but put him against a guy who grew up under a grassroots, basics, you know, all the way up, and the system that they learned is for self-defense. In other words, this is designed for fighting, whereas he came from a system that was designed for fighting and entertainment. So they didn't have a pure land view of how to proceed, and that makes a big difference. So I, because like for example, if you don't study Aikido, you don't think about it, and not many people do. I heard Joe Rogan one time, I would say diminish, but kind of marginalize the expression, it's from sword culture. And going back to the sword culture is kind of like what policemen go through. The reason that policemen use, they use Ikkyo, number one control, in Aikido, because they have to cuff people. There's no way to get around it. They practice Ikkyo all the time when they do it. It also happens to be one of the best ways to pass guard, because you try not to get into it. Because once you get into it, you have to be able to perform in that role. And at my age, my joints pop out like crazy. I try to adopt something that's a little bit more simple for my body, and that works for me. When you see somebody like Basrut, he's a martialist and a martial artist. So whenever he does anything, it's effective first, beautiful second. So he would do things in Pancras that were really cool. Like he had a fight with Suzuki, and he just decided, I'm going to do this. He put him up against the ropes. He turned around and spun for a knee bar. Like he just made it happen. Why? Because it looked cool. But would he do that in UFC? Probably not.
Yeah, absolutely. At what point did you start to change the way you were training to address your education or what you were learning from the UFC or your fights? Did that happen, or did you just continue to train the same way and then and kind of interpret that into whatever organization you're fighting at?
At some point, my heart, being the martial artist heart, at some point, I had done Aikido since I was a kid with the Kung Fu people that I knew, because it's essentially the same system. And in as much as I knew it wouldn't serve much purpose in the way of, you know, what I was doing for a living at the time, it's helpful. It's good for, it's kind of like the way that a lot of football players do ballet. You know, it's good for their balance. It's good for a lot of things, but it's not conducive to, you know, you need to fight now. You need to be good now. So I was, you know, always training boxing, always training wrestling, always training jiu-jitsu. But I hit a point in my career where I realized, you know, stuff starts breaking, stuff starts giving out, and I'm not going to be doing this forever. So I began to really focus. In fact, my sponsor in Japan took me to one of the Aikido dojos that I could train in Japan. And actually, Funaki and Suzuki and all those guys did a stint where they trained Aikido for just the same reasons. I started to change what I was doing personally simply because I knew when I retired, I wanted to teach, and I wanted to teach something that I would want to teach. And I knew that, you know, MMA was popular, I knew that jiu-jitsu was popular, but I didn't want to go into the realm that was, and I'll give you an example why I didn't want to. Some of my students, when I retired from teaching 2 years ago, one of my students is a kid named Lev Turkowitz. He's an outstanding jiu-jitsu guy. He competes all the time, but he's an Aikido student, and he does Aikido in jiu-jitsu tournaments. And the BJJ guys, he'll throw them with wrist throws and arm throws and entering throws, but it doesn't mean he wins the match. He's just doing that part of the art that is, you know, why would you try to get this off? Because if you do, it'll be cool. I mean, it's fun. They went to great school in Norwood, Mass. Called Connors Jiu-Jitsu. And from what I understand, Connors Jiu-Jitsu started off just Jiu-Jitsu, and he's really, traditionally minded. But there was a period of time where MMA guys were training there for fights, and he was training them and cornering and coaching. But it's too, there's not enough devotion. There's not enough, you know, people, bigger, better deal. They train for you, and then they find somebody else who's better. They move on. The tradition, the character, the integrity. much of what goes on in these environments. So I wanted to just be able to retire to an environment that was, you know, I only have a handful of students that, you know, made beyond black belt. Handful. But I'm happy with that lot because I'm not a businessman. I don't know how to run a school. Like, you think of how many great fighters the Gracies have made, how many great fighters that other schools have made. That's a talent. And if you don't have it, you're going to waste your time and be frustrated.
Where do you feel like that the UFC is going? The way that it's devolving now, is it going in the best direction, or do you think that it's going in the direction of the way that the professional wrestling thing developed?
Well, I hope it goes the way the professional wrestling develops, with the exception that I hope that they make a forum of expression that is real, like real shoots, but all it is no double leg takedowns, no single leg takedowns, all upper body throws and or submission. That's what I think they should do. And the reason I think that is, for me, ground and pound is ugly and it is dangerous. And the fighters today are so efficient. It's amazing, and thank God that it's not the case, but it's amazing that people aren't getting whacked all the time. You know, because I can't believe what happens to people. I mean, look what happens to us in training, just training. And then the fights themselves, these guys are putting it all out there. And, you know, it's like in boxing. A lot of my heroes from the 80s, they're dribbling now. They're punchy or they're dead from it. And I think UFC is, you know, they forget. These young kids go in there and they give everything that they have. I consider myself lucky to be alive with what I've done. The fighters now are so proficient, you know, any given day, something bad can happen. I don't want it to. So yeah, I think they should do something to, I mean, at least just get rid of ground and pound is my opinion. But, you know, what are you going to do about there's a ton of people who this is what they love. And I don't get it. To me, Jiu Jitsu was invented for a reason.
If you snapped your fingers, you're 24, 25, you know, 26, and you're stepping into the UFC today, how would you go about fighting? If this is what you're doing, let's just say, how would you go about fighting today with the best of the best?
Well, the recipe is still the same in the sense of, if you're talking about the UFC under the rules that are under now.
Yes.
You know, if you know the guys, you got to do one thing I never used to do, which was study my opponents. But you know, you study the guy. If he's a stand up, you go into the ground. If he's a ground guy, you're keeping him up. If your bag is you're fighting a guy who's equally matched, you're not caring about the win. You're caring about to go out there and give it your all. I mean, that's the best axiom that you can give somebody. I'd rather not finish a fight and regret not having tried something. So my ethos, and I taught it to my students, and I know some coaches would be like, you should have done this, you should have done that. But my ethos has always been, not the win, but how you fight. You know, live to die a glorious death kind of mentality. Like, go for it. Whatever you see next, just go for it. People go, oh no, because it's like, you know, if you go through life with that mentality, I think you miss a lot. And you can see a lot of fighters, they're consistent, but if it's entertainment, it's boring. Yeah, he wins every time. Yeah, but boring. You know, and to win, to see a guy like Sudo Genki always amazed me, the moves he would pull off in a ring, because he would do, I mean, whatever came out of his head, but he was a good example. He had the basics, so you can do stuff like that when you have the basics. Some guys go out and train and just, you know, superfluous, fantastic moves, but they can't fight. Yeah, you might be able to get that move off on a lesser opponent, but anybody with just basics will beat you. For me, my method now is so simplistic, I would probably be a boring fighter. Who knows? I don't like kicking anymore. Too old. But my punches, I punch a lot harder now than I ever did. That's years of just rigorous study and training. So what I would do now is maybe a lot more with my hands and maybe sweat the person out into having to take me down, because I know now, sometimes you hit so hard you break yourself. I'm kind of at that stage, so I would go like crazy and see what happens on the ground.
Sounds like a Chris Lieben kind of strategy, if you know who that is. Chris Lieben from the first season of Ultimate Fighter.
I do.
So, and he, you know, a fighter that probably win-loss ratio wasn't the best, but nobody ever booed Chris Lieben. You know, it was always a good fight.
Yeah, there are fighters that I can remember. Clay Guida?
Yep.
Guys who just throw their energy in there. They're not there for the win is not everything. We were at an event. It was at a casino that we put on. We had at the time a hybrid fighting. It was an amateur MMA organization, so we were the undercard for a pro card. So when I went into the corner of one of my guys who fought pro, one of the very reputable people there, my guy got hit in the groin, and he went down. It was a hard hit. He went down, and one of the reputable dudes there goes, "Tell him to stay down." And me and my other guy in the corner looked at him like, "Why?" And he goes, "Because you'll get the win." And we're just like, "The hell kind of thinking is that?" But that's a person who thinks win at all costs in any, you know, any way. To me, that's, you know, it's, there's more to it than that. There's more to it than that. But you know, everybody's got their belief. It's not mine, but
I'd say the best strategy, you know, from the limited perspective that we have for today's UFC, would be some kind of mixture of the two, right? As flashy as you can be while not making big, obvious mistakes. But
yeah.
No, that's a rare fighter, Anderson Silva, GSP, somebody like this. At what point? Sorry, go ahead.
No, that's okay.
At what point in your career in Pancrase did you feel like I'm getting tired of fighting? I know that you did fight afterwards, but when was it that you said, "I'm not having fun in Pancrase anymore"?
That was never the case with me. It's kind of funny because for the first year or so, I wasn't. And then when I finally got, all right, I'm in the groove, I'm in the zone, and I want to, all of a sudden they cut back on my fights. And I thought, what's going on? I'm grooving. They cut back on my fights and kind of took the momentum out of me for my peak. That was part of the issue, so that by the time I had gotten to go redo, you know, like once in a while fighting, I just didn't have any rhythm. But in the beginning, I was fighting once a month, sometimes twice a month, all year for 3 years, 4 years, something like that, was all the time. And when you're like that, you know, you get in a nice groove, and I didn't mind. After there was one fight, I broke my leg with Funaki. I threw a kick, and he blocked it with his elbow. And I broke that little bone, and I broke it, like, on an angle. After that, I noticed I was getting injuries all the time, in particular my right leg, because that bone never healed straight. It healed slight angles, like a radial. And all of a sudden, injury this, injury that. And it's like, oh, my God. But then it was just a case of, you know, traveling. Flying is really unhealthy for you. I don't know if you guys know, when you do that much flying, you get things like thrombosis, you get things like, you think of it on the average, and a lot of fighters go through this, 3 nights in a row, no sleep, both ways. So you travel, you get jet lag, you can't sleep, then you get a fight, then you come back, messed up from the fight, and, you know, after a while, you're a zombie. Like, to this day, from traveling, I don't sleep right, you know, 3 hours at a time kind of thing. Thrombosis, you know, your blood clotting in your body from flying. Those types of things were wearing me out, but I always wanted to continue on, but it was just a situation where they had already started to, like, Pancrase at some point when they finally, okay, we're wearing gloves and we're punching to the face. I was like, well, that was disappointing, but, you know, it didn't keep me from not wanting to do it. It kept me from to explain. But there were other elements over there. It wasn't just the wanting to or not wanting to fight. There were shady elements creeping in over there that were making my life in jeopardy. So I said, you know what? I don't need to be whacked out for an insurance policy, which was what I think they were working on. I wouldn't be the first, and they didn't get me, so.
Well, wow. That's something that I wanted to ask about, and if we need to edit this out, we absolutely will. I was going to ask, I know that when Pride started, that the Yakuza was very involved in that whole organization, like very involved. They would take people in the back room. I've spoken to people that were in the back room with the Yakuza, so they were there for sure, and they were telling people to do. Is that what was going on or starting to go on in Pancras?
No, for me it was, I had a few weird things happen to me in a row, and the culmination of it came to this one fight where it was at the end of a contract, and I had one fight left, but that was one of those years where they weren't using me. My contract was for so many fights, and they were using me sporadically, and I had one fight left on my contract, but my contract was over for that next visit. And so I get a call the day before I'm ready to leave, and they said, and they told me for that fight, I was training for the very first, what we had was catch wrestling. So, which was basically was going to be pro wrestling, a real shoot, just wrestling. So they said, you're going to fight Suzuki this month with pro wrestling, catch wrestling. So I said, sure. So I trained a month and a half for this fight. The night before I left, I got a call, and they said, there's a fight for the Russian Seikendo organization, and we need you to fight in that fight. I says, I've been training a whole month and a half catch wrestling. I says, this Seikendo was Thai boxing with throws and 10 seconds on the ground. You had 10 seconds, no submissions. You had to just punch the guy. I says, you're kidding me, right? I says, I'm not ready for this. And the guy said, well, if you want to fulfill your contract, then you need to do it. So, okay, rock and a hard place, I do it. I agree to it. Okay, so long story short, I do the fight with Suzuki. I beat him. So now I've got less than a week to train for this Seikendo organization. It was getting weird. That whole time was messed up with me. And so the night of the fight, we go there for a weigh-in. I'm fighting in the unlimited division. I'm 185 pounds, but it doesn't matter. The guy I'm fighting, I don't know, he's 220, some shit like that. But he says, we got to go for the weigh-ins early. I says, it's unlimited. Why do I need to weigh in? There's no weight. He goes, we have to go. So we go. And it's cold there. Tokyo at that time was winter. So we go in and we weigh in. Okay, we're all done. He says, we're going to wait here till the event starts. It's like 6-8 hours later or something. He says, go if you want. The van is running. He says, go warm up in the van. Stay warm. I said, okay. I went to the van. I sat in the van, and it was in the basement parking garage up against the wall in the back, and I started to get sick, like I want to throw up bad. My head starts hurting. So I get out of the van and I go to throw up, and I'm in the back of the van trying to hide, and while I'm throwing up, I look and I can see that somebody put the rusted end of a tuna can over the tailpipe. Carbon monoxide. So I knew that's why I was getting sick, and I knew it was done on purpose. I know something's going on, and it wasn't the first time something had happened to me where I didn't want to go into too many stories. There's one time I remembered getting in, this was all within the kind of the year span, and I remember getting in the van, and this is right from the airport, I forget who was in the van with me, but the guy, the company road manager, he goes, would you like a bottle of water? And he's never offered me a bottle of water in 8 years. I go, yeah, sure. And I took it, and I drank it. And as soon as I drank it, tunnel vision, all kinds of shit. And he looks over and he goes, do you feel like you've been poisoned? And I look at him. Now I'm in delirium. I look at him like, you evil mother. Like, you piece of shit. And I knew by these various things put together, other things besides it. But those two things were like, all right, my days are numbered. I can remember the guys that disappeared. Hasegawa was one of them. That was a guy I fought three times. He fell out of a building. Really? You know, shit like that happens. Andy Hoog, I don't believe that was what they said. They told me he died of leukemia. Well, he showed up in Japan for a fight, and the day he showed up, they took him to the hospital, and he died of leukemia. That don't seem right. So I think that there's a certain period of time where entertainment insurance, because I don't know if you guys know this, but entertainment insurance is suicide doesn't matter because you're a property, you're not a person. So they do anything. If you get whacked, they get paid. And that's just another scam they got over there.
So was this the first time that when this series of events started to happen, was this the first time in your fighting career anything strange happened? Or was it pretty much, you know, like by the book in the UFC, just a fight, no problem?
No, I mean, you get weird things happen all the time. And I mean, as years go by, I look back and money notwithstanding, UFC was really, especially for what I was in, because I was in just the first two, it was really well done, the way that they took care of, you know, the event, the people, and as straightforward as it could be. I think they did a really good job, especially because it was the ground floor. I mean, nobody had ever done this in 100 years. UFC didn't give me that vibe. I'm not sure of what goes on there now, because it's so huge. Being over in Japan, you see a lot of things, and after a while, it's like, it's not a coincidence. It's just, you know, trying to keep your nose clean.
How did that, your fighting, knowing that the people are legitimately trying to kill you?
It's just one of those, you realize where you're at, and I don't want to say too much about the ends of business that you know, I may or may not have been in, but like, over there, the way they do things, depending on the organization, like I had heard that in certain realms, like K-1 or something like it, trying to be, you know, ambiguous, that they would come up between rounds and tell you, hey, you gotta put a guy over. You know, if that's how they did it, we had weird things happen with us. There were weird things going on everywhere, and even though there's shoots every once in a while, somebody's got to bet somewhere. You guys know how gambling works in Japan? There is none. So, like pachinko, you know how pachinko works? So, pachinko is that pinball game that they play. So, in Japan, you go play pachinko, you win a bunch of balls. You go up to the guy, you give him the balls, and they give you a pack of pencils, different colored pencils. You take the pencils outside, and there's a guy in a window who will buy those pencils off you for $300-$400. Crazy, because gambling is illegal. You know, so they just have their way, and it's endemic. I mean, it's woven into their society that when they tell you a thing, it means this. If they say this, but it means that. So, you know, you're never absolutely sure. I got a really good sense. One time I went and I did an interview with Kevin Randleman in his home, and I got to talk to him a bit about, you know, his goings on in Japan. And yeah, it's a rough climate. It depends what company you work for.
Did anybody ever outright ask you to lose on purpose?
Moving right along.
Do you think that the ethics of the fights in Japan, you know, unrelated levels, say unrelated, the ethics in the fights in Japan offered up a product that was anywhere close to reality, or was it in the middle?
I used to love to watch Pride as a great example. You know, and so when people would watch Pride, they'd be like, oh, that's the balls. And then you see, if you see a Pride fighter fighting UFC, well, what's the difference? The cage. You know, it's what's close to, also, for example, Gerard Gordeau with that young kid. I forget the kid's name, but he poked that kid's eye out. You hear about that?
No, what was, in what event was it? Oh, it was was, Yuki Nakai, yes.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, that was just to prove the point. I mean, sucks that it had to happen that way, but he, you know, he's talking to one of these people who's, Rod Gordo's, and he was always good to me, but you look into his eyes, there's a guy who just doesn't care. But he wouldn't, it's not like he'd go out and you know, murder somebody, let's say, but, you put him in a fight, you tell him there's no rules, he'll go, no rules? Yes, okay, and just do it, you know? I mean, it's what's close to a real fight is, I guess, who you fight. I remembered after Funaki fought Boss the last time, I remember Boss, he had been front choked, and like, Boss has a front choke, like, oh my God, he could pull your head off your body, and Ruben could, Funaki could barely talk, and I went up to him, and I said something nice in his ear, and he looked at me, and he went, Boss tried to kill me. Now, yeah, he pretty much tries to kill everybody, but within the rules, you know? So would you say, a real fight, it's like, there are some guys who, even though they're not gouging your eyes or biting you or, you know, anything like that, their intent, their power gives them the, yeah, that's a real fight. Why? Because he was trying to explode your guts with it, or he was trying to break your neck with his shin bone, or, you know, that's a real fight. It's as close to a real fight as you can get.
Out of all of your fights, who do you feel like that you landed the best shot on?
I got the best shot ever landed was on Suzuki in our last fight. It was just so perfectly timed that on a three-punch, cross in the hook, the snap of the hook hit just right that it shut him out. I think I must have hit him on the point of his head, but it shut his lights off immediately, and it almost broke my hand, like down the middle. It was so hard. When you look at it, because it's open hand, but it's funny because I think to this day I'd be more comfortable knocking somebody out with my palms than with a fist, and it seems weird because if you're not used to hitting with your open hands, it wasn't always like that. For the first 2 years, every time we fought open hands, when I was done, you would bruise your hands on this side so bad that it would come out on the back. After a fight for days, you couldn't pick up a fork. You couldn't even stuff your hands in your pockets because you didn't have the control. But over the years, like some kind of qigong, my sinew and my bones are dense. And when I hit, I know it. I hit stuff. And even I do it, what I would do is sparring. And when I say sparring, you know, training guys to fight. But when I would hit guys in the head with an open hand, they would remark after, like, what the hell? And it's just, you know, it's conditioning. But Suzuki in that fight, I just remembered feeling my energy go into his head and crumple his head. I remember hitting Chris Lytle one time pretty good with an entry. I did an entry move, and I hit him really hard. He said to me after the fight, I think my neck is a little shorter now. I tried my best to put a palm heel through Boss's liver, but to no effect, and I knew it wouldn't have much effect because at some point in that fight, I remember throwing a kick at his head, and he blocked it with his head, so that was kind of dispiriting. Yeah, manly. I think the best fights probably a lot of us have landed were in training, not in the fights.
How does the punch change from, you know, a regular punch to having to punch no palm strike?
It's a different contact point, but it's also a different, you get to do things with your open hands. Like, for example, if I'm going to throw this hand that way, when you learn how to chamber, like the way you'll chamber for a punch, whether it's this chamber, but with an open hand, you start a rotation that goes in, so your hand may start backwards as it's traveling. The rotation timed with the turning of the hips, that extra whip with the hand and the surface, like this surface versus this, a lot of guys, they do open hands, they're hitting up here, but if you're hitting with this surface and you're conditioned, it's devastating, especially because there's no give. So like when you punch, if your hand may falter, there's no falter. This is like the end of a 2x4. So when you do it right, whether you're doing this with this, your force goes into it. You know how a bullwhip works. They say that a bullwhip breaks the sound barrier. By virtue of the ratio by which you're pulling this, the base of the whip back, and this one passing it, that it's actually traveling faster than sound, which is why you get pop. So that's kind of the same thing. You can time an extra rotary movement into the strike, and if you're doing it right, and you time it right, that is extremely powerful, in particular along the sides of the skull, where the jawline meets the air, that kind of thing.
And evidently to the body. But
if you do it good. I remembered after we fought, boss was talking to me about the liver. We were in a restaurant, and he reached down, he put his hand on my liver, and he pressed it in, because he knows he's done so many. He just pressed in on my liver, and I was like, whoa. You know, you could feel it. And you get that same sensation as if you were punched, but not debilitating. You could just feel like, oh, that doesn't feel good. That's a product of, you know where it is. So things like that, and knowledge. Maurice Smith was another great example. He taught me how he uses shins, and he had me stand in front of him, and he just laid his shin on my thigh and rubbed my thigh. Oh, my God. I was like, oh, please don't ever do that again. The amount of, you take a guy like that and put him in against a guy who's never done leg kicks, or never done them serious like that. I mean, he could chop me down with just leg kicks. I would not want to be hit by Boris in the thigh.
Yeah, I saw Pedro, his fight in person, and throwing those leg kicks, even we were like way up in the audience, but that's the one technique that far up that I could still hear. That's incredible. Could you imagine? I mean, you could, but that's serious damage being created.
When you meet Pedro Izzo, I met him once, and you just could tell by the thickness of his body, his manhood, that it would be a bad day. Yeah, he's powerful.
Yeah, he's kind of built like it's hard to even explain, like just a rhinoceros or something. He's just built solid, but super nice.
Like Ken used to tell us about the Polynesian guys, any of the Samoans. He had that kind of thickness in his bones. Ken used to tell us, he says, if you ever fight a Samoan, never try to heel hook him. He'll just laugh at you. I can believe it.
Considering that where you arrived with your perception of palm strikes, who would you say hit you the hardest or landed the most effective strike, regardless of palm strike or a regular punch?
Well, to this day, of all the, you're asking about the palm strike?
Well, in general, period, in your professional fighting career, who landed?
Bob Stein. Bob Stein hit so hard that, do you know Ian Freeman?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, English guy.
Ian Freeman knocked him out after I got knocked out by him. And Ian Freeman, when I saw him after that, he said the same. He goes, I never felt a guy hit me, even though Ian won that fight. He says, the guy hit, and when he hit you, we both said the same thing at the same time. You saw a blue flash. And Bob Stein's a real karate guy. His punches were so, if he was landing, there was something just wicked about them. And it was traumatizing. The first punch he threw glanced off of me, and it traumatized me. It made me literally shit myself, like, oh my God, I hope this guy doesn't touch me, like that. But he had the most devastating punch that I ever felt of any human alive, and I've, in gyms, anywhere. And the only other one that I would guess would be as bad, probably worse, I would actually dare say worse, would be Semi Schultz. And I never fought him, but I was supposed to fight him. And in training, I broke a rib, and I didn't know I was going to fight him. And when I got a hold of the pancreas office, and I told him, I says, I broke a rib, I'm going to send you the x-ray so you can see. He said, do you know who you were going to fight? And I go, Semi, wasn't he? He goes, yeah. It's like, thank God. I never wanted to fight that young man.
How would you deal with a 7-foot-tall guy? Get on the inside?
One hellacious shot to a flurry to a clinch. Whatever it took to, like Hickson running down the judo fighters in the dojo, my shot would be so direct and so in, and my clinch would be so desperate and sincere. Yeah. And it's funny because I fought Hasegawa, who was much smaller than me, and he wound up catching Semi in a toe hold and tapping him. Not that I think that was just Semi's inexperience being safe, but still, the guys that Semi would, everybody that he would whack out to deliver, you could just be like, I think he need Guy Metzger like in the hip bone. He's the only guy I ever saw that Leon Dyke and Boss Rude, maybe it was Boss too, but Leon holding tie pads for him, and just for a warm up before a fight. And when he put him down, he was like, it hurt. Semi Schultz was ungodly powerful.
He's also landing from a distance. This like 2.5 distances too far for you, right? Like you got to be way on the outside.
The guys that I know who trained with him said, you know, you're far enough away you think he can't touch you, and all of a sudden he can put his knee on your face. And I mean, you figure a guy's 7 feet tall, so yeah, words elude me, but basically your best estimate of where he is, yeah, it's not true. I remember messing around with him once. I hadn't seen him in a while, and I loved him. He was such a gentleman, such a great a good person. You could see in his face he's just a pure person, pure man. And I went one time joking, like I was shooting on him, and he scooped me like a little kid. Like he put one hand on my liver, you know, Dutch style. He put one hand on my liver and the other hand he just grabbed me, and I was like, oh, that would have been tragic. Thank God I never fought him.
And he went on to have some hellacious fights too in Pride and different organizations.
Bought a Harley.
Yeah. He's fantastic. And a lot of modern fans won't know these names, but these were guys that were like unbelievable. Right? And, you know, going back to the first UFC, second UFC, I would say you have to love it for what it is and not hate it for what it isn't.
Yeah.
The view of the modern fan is that that type of fighting is boring and it's, you know, less reminiscent of a real fight when it's completely backwards, right? It might indeed have to be boring, but that just means I'm not getting my ass kicked, right? So
that's where you're back to the art of jiu-jitsu is a great example. The art of jiu-jitsu, for it to fulfill its purpose, is not designed to be exciting. It just so happens that people are so good at it now, you can get somebody in there that can wow you. But and that pisses me off when you see guys, they're busting their balls and they're really, you know, their life is at risk, and a fan to boo it.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of the fan, you know, to boo somebody who's in there risking their life to do this, you know, respect. You never see Thai boxers talking trash to each other with Thailand, you know.
That's a good point.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of what they do to promote. That's why this whole trash talking press conferences and all this stuff, no animosity is good. None of it. You know, it's enough to, and it's funny because, you know, the people who make the rules like ground and pound, Dana White, ground and pound, press conferences, talking shit, all that shit, that's funny. That's the guy who's never been in a fight making the fighters do it. I don't like it. I don't like it one bit.
Yeah, it's kind of, it's akin to kind of just shaking up two kids and telling them, you know, do your worst, just go wild, and then throwing them at each other. It showcases disrespect rather than the ability of the fighters, and that sucks.
Yep.
Do you think that the Ultimate Fighter, that program, is where that started, or where was it?
I've never watched the program. I do know that somebody was showing me these excerpts of life in the dojo kind of thing, and these guys were getting, they were getting drunk and obnoxious, urinating on people's stuff and stuff like that. And all I thought was, this is the generation that followed. So, okay, I'm the first generation of that genre. And obviously stories float around about the life that we live. You know, we're like rock stars. We're traveling all the time. And it's almost like they're just trying to emulate to get another. And it's like, don't. You know, we did a lot of things that I'm sure that we weren't proud of as, you know, young adults, drunk adults, whatever it was, but they're glorifying it. Why would you? You know, this is the decline of modern civilization as we know it. What is wrong with people? And not to mention, look at people who have character like old days Marciano, Joe Louis, real gentlemen. Look at people who are like that. Francis Ngannou, you know, he ain't going to talk shit for Dana White.
No.
Well, he is not, right? But the fighters who have the best, I remember Carlos Valente said to me about Thaddeus Luster. Thaddeus Luster was all the time before the fight, quiet, gentleman. And Carlos said, watch out for a guy like that, quiet, humble. And that's the kind of guy. When I met Hickson didn't say two words to me, but he walked up and he put his hand on my back after a good fight. You know, you get that feeling from a person that you could feel their character coming through. You see the people who are, you know, all full of themselves, yelling and screaming. You don't even feel good being near them. Not to mention, that's the kind of guy, yeah, he'll do good for a while, but when it goes bad for him, it's going to go really bad. It's just, it's bad karma to be that way. I don't like it.
So you felt like that, I mean, you know, in our culture, Hickson is the guy. He's the grand master. You actually feel like you felt his spirit, or you felt his, I don't know what the word would be, chi?
Absolutely did. Absolutely did. In fact, you just said it, and I can't show you, but I ran up my spine. Absolutely did, and kind of one of those things that you don't forget. Like, the only other time I remember having a feeling that strong was my my father-in-law, who came from the killing fields. The amount of holes in his body from various confluence, you know, you could imagine. Never said two words, but as soon as you meet him, you could feel it. I get that from Hickson. It's kind of, and it's not a bad thing. It's a word I want to say. It's spiritual. It's intensely spiritual.
And I actually know what you mean. You know, we've trained with Hickson's brothers. We've trained with different members of the family, and I feel like a lot of them have something akin to what you're talking about, where it's almost like that they're capable of passing along messages without saying anything. I've never experienced that before or since, so that's an interesting thing that you said there. I've never heard anybody else to say that. Did you ever have a chance to train with Hickson or anything else with Hickson?
No, just that I knew that, like I told the story before, but so UFC 1, there was a point in time when there was an award ceremony for the father.
There you go.
And yeah, everybody was doing their thing, and for whatever reason, they asked me to walk their father to the stage behind the curtain. Just me. I did not know why, but it always, for the same reason, it always stuck with me that, you know, Royce and I for a while had a row because I wanted to fight him again, and if he'd have beat me the third time, I would want to fight him again. That's just how I am. But I deeply respected his family just for the honor that they had as a family, you know, just to see a family that close, to see a family that big that close, to see a family that devoted to something that their father gave them, to see, you know, everything about it was inspiring to me and powerful, motivating.
When you see, like, bullying these days be as bad as it is, and kids are committing suicide from being bullied, and you hear there are policies in schools that punish both kids for fighting, the kid for standing up for himself and the bully. How do you tell these parents, no, it's okay for your kid to fight that kid if he's done, you know, follow the right steps? There is honor in fighting. How do you pass that message along?
I try to say it with regard to the way I've always looked at fighting, which is I simply say, like, policemen, I've trained a lot of policemen, a lot of my friends who are policemen, I would tell them, when you greet a person, no matter the circumstances, even if it's let's say you got the call and the guy you're pulling over is, you already figured this is going to go down bad. The first thing you should do when you walk up to the guy, hand on, gun ready, is to start off with sir, please, ma'am, please, whatever. Because spiritually, you're justified. But when you see guys who go up and they run, you know, what the hell do you think you've already distracted your own intentions. You're not justified spiritually because, you know, in your head, somewhere in your head is thinking, well, I call him an asshole, so he responded, whatever it is. But in every case, absolutely try to avoid it until you're not avoiding it. Because everything that you were taking, all the energy you were using, like a slingshot, you were trying to get away from it, trying to avoid it. Okay, now I've got to turn back. That means everything that you were using to get away is now going right at this person. And that's part of the, I think, the formula for you tend to win when you're right.
Yeah. And we agree 110%, no doubt about it. We have a lot of parents, or have had, that will say, no, I want you to teach my son or my kid to avoid the fights or to not fight. We don't want them to be bullied, but we don't want them to fight either. And that sometimes is a difficult conversation to have, because at some point there has to be a fight. If the bullying doesn't stop, something has to stop it. And if it's you, then it's you. But that's a difficult conversation to have with a parent that doesn't believe in fighting. So how do you phrase it to her?
I think sometimes you have to point out the raw reality is there are some times where you will not be able to get out of a fight. Not to mention, some people view your compassion, your kindness as weakness. And that person, because they're cowards, turns on more. And so, would you rather, you know, you can say to a parent, you can trust me that if your kid is gonna get in a fight anyway, to know when to versus not to, at least if he knows when to and does what I tell him, he'll win. Or be safer than if he simply adopts, okay, I'm a pacifist, I don't fight. The first moment of that fight is the crucial part. You want your kid to get hurt or not. You know, because it comes down to, yeah, I don't want him fighting either. But there are times, many pillars of violence that you deal with. There are times when you can't escape it, so you may have to act first, or else your safety is now in jeopardy. Not to mention, it can be done in such a way, like, I used to be a bouncer in a bar in a place in Rhode Island, and I've had to deal with people on a couple of occasions. And I was young. I was 18, 19. But when one kid I remember in particular, I had to choke him out because he was out of his mind. And as he was going out, the last thing he heard from me was, we don't want any trouble. We don't want any trouble. When he woke up, he became my friend. And this kid was a thug. We had a similar situation where a guy had just gotten back from Iraq in Woonsocket, Rhode Island. And he was shut down in a bar, two bouncers. And they shut him down, but they killed him like a punk. He came back and killed them both with a knife just because of the way that they addressed him. So, I mean, you tell the parents that, you know, if the kid wins, he'll gain the kid. He can make a friend out of this kid who was just trying to fuck with him.
Yeah, so we don't want our kids to fight. We want them to avoid the fight at all costs. But what we're doing with this, you know, martial arts approach is dealing with the worst case scenario. What if you can't avoid the fight? What if you must fight them? What if they attack you? Then what do you want your child to respond with? Because there has to be some first response, right? Just cower. But that's, if they're not training for it, that's the that's either your natural reaction, or your natural reaction is to become a, you know, like a predator. When did you, now that I think about it, when did you in your mind believe, you know, I'm a good fighter?
in my ability since I was very young. I've always known, like, from where I came from to get to, like, UFC, where I'm from, essentially I was kind of a big fish in a small pond, but I had a lot of guys around me that could kick my butt boxing. I had guys who could kick my butt wrestling, but I always kind of had that, the wrestler I can box with and the boxer I can wrestle, and it, you know, worked very well, but in a small pond. When I stepped into the larger arena, I saw walks of life that are just like, really? You know, people you scarce believe exist. And that's another good, you know, back to when you're talking about, what about, you know, teaching people how to fight and that they don't want to fight? All the more reason that you should adopt the attitude, which is absolutely do everything you can to avoid it, but train yourself kind of like the policeman with the, he's got to walk up to a car with his hand on his gun. And starts with, sir or ma'am, please, knowing that at any second, sir or ma'am, please could be followed with, and you have to tell the parents that to be successful, to be safe, there may be a time when he has to fight, and you should encourage that he or she learns this method the proper way, or do you want your child to be hurt? You know, and you have to explain it because that's the reality we live in, and the world's not getting better. I used to tell cops, this is 30 years ago, I used to tell cops that there are more people practicing MMA than there are cops. And because in the beginning, a lot of them didn't want to cross-train because they had a curriculum of things that they do, largely because a lot of it's based on use of force. So they don't want to deviate from the methods that they have to adopt. But then as they realized, yeah, this is probably everybody. So back in the old days, in America anyway, policemen did Aiki Jiu Jitsu. Kids, regular population, did karate. Why? We all know why. Because we don't want people knowing Jiu Jitsu. We want them doing high kicks and stuff that we can easily remedy. You know, that's the way it used to be. Nowadays, look out, you go out there, how many you don't know. And the people that are good at it, even less so, you know, because you can't tell anymore. You can make a guy 140 pounds who can beat a guy 250 pounds. You know, the poor cop who's going to deal with that, if he doesn't see it coming, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you were, this just popped into my mind, the original challenge match with Steven Seagal they wanted to have. Was that kind of sparked by your training in Aikido and just distaste for him and his kind of anti-martial arts lifestyle?
No, I mean, this was 1992, and I was still a kid, especially at heart, but I, you know, who didn't want to be Bruce Lee? And so you see a guy who's a martial artist, you can tell. He makes his claim to fame on saying something like that. Well, you said it. I wouldn't mind, you know, the assets that you have based on that. If you're real, then you'll meet this. If I beat you, I want a movie deal. But, you know, that's what you're thinking as a kid. And then you realize he's not even going to honor this. So he gets to go to give you, I might have told this story to somebody before. There used to be a show called The Current Affair. You ever heard of it? I called them and told them what I was doing, and their answer was, we're not going to touch this. And then, like, a few weeks later, they came out with a interview with some guy who decided he's challenging Sylvester Stallone to a fight because he doesn't like the fact that Stallone made Vietnam movies and he wasn't in Vietnam. And I was like, you're going to publish that, but here you have Steven Seagal dropping a challenge. And he won't answer it, but that's not newsworthy. I don't get it, but that's Hollywood.
Speaking of that, this was around the time Frank Dukes was claiming to be a ninja and a bunch of bullshit, you know, like just crazy stuff. Did you ever try to get a fight with him or anything? I know that a couple of people have, but maybe our viewers don't.
I didn't. two reasons, one of which was I had heard, the first time was I had heard already from people that I knew that they said he had plagiarized the life of a fighter named Paul Vizio, who was a great kickboxer. And they said basically he plagiarized his life and made it his own. So, you know, we've all seen this type of person. It wasn't an interest to me at the time. You know, none of that really. I mean, the whole movie Bloodsport had a kind of, although it's kind of funny because look at UFC, right? But Bloodsport was kind of hokey to me. I saw it, but, you know, it wasn't that much. But the Steven Seagal thing, just by the way he would word it, especially because you remember in context, he's talking shit about my heroes, Bob Wall, Chuck Norris, Bill Wallace, you know, talking shit about them when you've never been in a fight. Really? Really? So that was the other part of that, which was a little bit of, yeah, like you said, integrity of his attitude. And nobody knew it back in the day what a dick he was. And to find out later that, you know, I don't know anybody who met him who didn't go, that guy's an ass.
Absolutely. You know, just as a side note, that book of Frank Duke's, among the things that he claims to be a Navy SEAL, a Medal of Honor recipient, a spy, a Russian, some government position, an MMA fighter, you know, like goes on and on and on. It's just confirmable things that did not happen.
Yep.
But at this time period, not so much of that was public knowledge. Was it just around the fighters that you guys knew, like, yeah, that guy's just full of shit?
Well, because in the other thing that happened shortly thereafter, which was, so I was in Hollywood in 92. In 93, I met Zane Frazier, who kicked Frank Dukes' ass.
Yeah.
You know, so I got Zane Frazier, who's fighting in the UFC, telling me he kicked Frank Dukes' ass. I got no reason to doubt Zane Frazier, and I got every reason to doubt Frank Dukes. That was an easy, been done, in other words. So when you're fighting the Gracies, you're thinking at the time, you're like, nobody's ever beaten these guys. Imagine being the first. You know, that's inspiring. Frank Dukes, no, nobody really cared that much.
Yeah, if somebody beat up Frank Dukes now or then, it probably wouldn't make the newspapers or front pages of anything, because it would just be like liar gets beat up.
Right. Well, it's kind of like the Seagal thing. The whole, when you got that much power in Hollywood, they're just gonna sweep it under the carpet. No one's ever gonna know. No one's ever gonna hear. I mean, I was at his school every day for 6 months, every class, waiting. And it's not like I just walked in waiting for him to show up. I walked up to Harawa. I gave him the magazine. I said, this is what he wrote. This is my answer. And I'll be here every day until he answers. And you could see he was like, you know, what are you going to do about it? He said it, and I'm here, you know. And nobody ever heard of it. Nobody ever knew. Really?
So was he coming up to you, like, every night saying he hasn't said anything yet, or just ignoring it?
No, I would, time to time, I would talk to him. And finally, they had moved. And I don't know how long he was at that school, but that was the school they used to film Above the Law, the beginning scene. But after about 4 or 5 months, they actually moved that school. They closed it, and they moved it to, like, a YMCA in Santa Monica. This was, like, after the riots. But I had occasion. I would go to Santa Monica, which is quite a distance away, and I would bother them there just to go, you know, I'm not going anywhere. Finally, I ran out of money. I had to go home. But, you know, I made sure that there's no way you could say that, no, I don't remember him showing up, really.
What's the technique? How was that aspect of the classes they were teaching?
It was a great dojo. Haro is a great teacher. I don't know how he put up with Steven Seagal for so long, but Haro was a great teacher. I liked observing. I learned a lot by watching. See, if you guys ever watched, remember what we said about the pro wrestling is what MMA 100 years ago turned into? But if you've ever noticed the moves in pro wrestling, it's all Aikido moves.
Yeah, absolutely it is. Yeah. Oh, that's interesting. I've never thought about it that way, but yeah, that's absolutely what it is. And they're the most flashy moves. They look the best.
Yeah, so
that's.
People wonder about it working and stuff. It's like if you Aikido is the wrestling that you would learn as a sword fighter. If you wanted your Aikido to work against a boxer, you have to also know how to box. Against the wrestler, you have to also know how to wrestle. And people, you know, the most Aikido people know the spiritual. This is spiritual. Nothing. It's wrestling. It's wrestling that was devised fighting with weapons. If not for fighting with a sword, no one would have ever invented half the techniques that are in it. I give you a good one. You ever hear that kid named Dotsig, Russian kid, crazy guy?
Dotsig.
I think his name is Dotsig. He's the one who, if you ever seen, they show him way, way back in the day. He beat Andrei Arlovsky in Russia before he was ever famous. But this kid is psychotic. But he does Aikido and fights sometimes. Albeit he does it sometimes in a boxing match, because he'll do MMA boxing. But, you know, crazy as he is, he knows some Aikido moves and he does them. You know, just a kind of side note there.
Yeah. Do you feel like the legitimacy of the dojo and Steven Seagal's cowardice are in opposition? Is he the way that he is just because he's a coward, or is there something else to it?
Well, I think he's like so many Aikido people that he's never been in a fight. He'll tell you how he's been in a fight, but he's never been in a fight. It's not that he's a martial artist. What he's performing is real, but he's never performed it in a live environment, which is too bad, because there are branches of Aikido that when you practice freestyle Aikido, the people practicing, it's incumbent upon you to use only the techniques, the traditional techniques. So you don't do double single leg takedowns, that kind of thing. You're actually only using first five controls, hip throw, entering throw, and four directions throw, which is when you throw a guy back this way. And you're supposed to, they fit together in a way that it looks just like a kung fu movie. But it's just an art. It's for fun. That's the way they train to get better at it. But it's an actual sport. It's what pro wrestling would look like if you said, only these moves are allowed, and both people did it. It looks really cool. It's fun. But it's not how you'd fight in a fight. But you can get those moves off in a fight, but you could only do it if you knew how to also box, wrestle, like that. He's never boxed, wrestled. You know, he's basically full of shit.
Do you think that he was just doing that for the publicity, or is he delusional?
No, totally for the publicity. Totally. Yeah, think of it. I get to say this, and in those days, nobody knew that the internet was going to be what it was. Nobody knew that you were going to be able to pick up your phone, flip phone. You're going to be able to pick up your phone and film a person running from a fight, or you know, any of this stuff. I think he just got ahead of himself thinking, who's going to know? Well, guess what? Everybody knows. In fact, some people did the research, and him and Frank Dukes, you know, the CIA, any of that stuff, really?
And the people that didn't know that before will know it now, so at least.
Yeah, everybody.
How do you, as far as dealing with your mind before a fight or in a fight, how do you deal with the nerves, that kind of fear that's impossible to get away from?
I think I have an attribute that it either came to me over time, or maybe I've always had it, but I remember Nathan Marcotte. You know Nathan Marcotte?
Yeah, I sure did, yeah.
When he was young, he was fighting for Pancras, but when he was young, I remember him being in the dressing room with us. I think I've told this story before, too, if I'm repeating myself. But he said, don't you ever get nervous? And as soon as he said it, I looked over at Yuki Kondo. I go, wait a second. I go, Yuki, do you get nervous? He goes, yes. So I go, I must get nervous, because he's not scared of nothing. Like, you're doing it for so long. It's, second nature. I don't know. But, yeah, no, it never really bothered me, that part of it. Why?
Did that evolve, or were you like that, you know, before you were even fighting Royce or any of that stuff? just bare-knuckle fights.
I think the only time I ever was affected was... I think the only time that I ever really was affected was I was scared shit of Boss Rudin. And before I fought Bob Steins, I had seen what he had done to some previous opponents. And I had that feeling of... But with Bob Steins, it wasn't a nervousness. With Boss Rudin, it was a... I was, for whatever reason, I was like, this is it. I'm finally going to have to pay. And justly so, because it wasn't just an imagination. He was a freak of nature. Boss Rudin was unreal. Unreal competitor.
Oh, yeah. If Boss wanted to fight us three right now, it would be a challenge, all three of us. So Boss is a beast among beasts. And I actually got to see Boss fight once too, which is a crazy experience as well.
In a street fight?
No, in the UFC.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so he did really well. And if I remember, I could hear his corner, but I could hear him over his corner. Like, he was talking louder than the corner was talking.
Yeah.
Interesting. So, if you could go back, I know that you've been asked some of these questions before, but not for the people that are going to be listening to this podcast. If you could go back and do the whole thing, your whole career over again, you would probably do it, right?
Yeah, I would.
Would you do it the same way?
I would have, at some point in time. Maurice Smith had extended the invitation to me for me to train with him. In fact, after my third fight with him, Boss Rudin had invited me to train in Holland. But I definitely would have sought out one of the two of them, for I can tell you that for what I felt I wanted, needed, was an acumen in stand-up that men like that had. And they were also very good at, you know, certain people are like this. Not everybody can be like this. Kevin Randleman was like this. Kevin Randleman in one day taught me more about throwing, and not any specific technique, just a principle. And Maurice was like that. I learned more about Thai boxing in hotel lobbies from Maurice than I could have learned in a gym if I'd have gone, just because of the way he knew how to teach and he knew what I needed. And Boss Rudin was the same. He taught me things and simple, but he knew, you know, he knows by looking at you, you need this instead of this, or you need, you know, a certain thing. And when somebody has that affinity for knowledge, you can use it right away. Boss would show me weird little things and I could do them that night in the fight. You know, usually they'll tell you, don't do something until you've mastered it in the dojo. We'd be at the venue, he'd show me something and I'd go do it and be like, wow, yeah, that was cool. You know, sometimes that's you know, you can't get that from the anything but the person. It has to be a special person who teaches like that. But I would definitely have gone and trained Thai boxing with someone like that, because I feel that's an element that I could have spent more energy on.
Do you think that had you not shown up at the Gracie Academy, never met Royce, never gotten to the UFC, that you would have still ended up fighting at some point? Or do you think that was the rocket booster?
That was definitely the once in a lifetime, right place, right time, took advantage, you know, didn't look back kind of thing. Yeah, that was, had it not been for that, none of this would have happened for me.
And what do you think?
It's funny because I look at, there were people in my region, I'm in New England, that there were people in my region that were approached that turned it down, kind of wanted to see what would happen. And a lot of them regretted it because you never get a chance to say you were in UFC 1. You only get one chance, and then, you know, that's a big thing.
And were you the actual first fight that night, just not televised?
No, it was between, they needed a rest before Gerard, Gordeaux, and Hoist fought. So we were that intermission fight so that they could, you know, Gerard was fighting. He had a broken foot with teeth lodged inside of it, and he had a broken hand. So he needed a small stay. But they wanted also just a little time lapse between, so that's when they put us on. We originally were just there as alternates and weren't going to fight, but they figured, why the hell not?
So at some point, was there the opportunity that you could have fought, or was it you were just going to fight as, like, what was that? I don't know if I missed you just saying it.
So originally, we as alternates were just there in case somebody got injured out. So, like, if Gordo couldn't have continued because of his broken foot, you know, one of us would have went in. But then the snap decision was made just before the main event that Trent Jenkins and I would fight as an intermission. And that's how that came about. Originally wasn't even slated.
So was that a letdown that you weren't going to be at least in the main draw of that card, or were you just happy to be fighting?
It was and it wasn't, because after I had seen, like, I had never met Kevin Rogier, and if you saw, I was in Kevin Rogier's corner.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Kevin Rogier was enormous. And you know, Zane Frazier was, in those days, I was a 175-ish. And Ken Shamrock, he had a body like Adonis, you know, and look at all these guys, and I'm like, oh, my God. You know, like, if I get in there, what's going to happen? I figured I have enough to put up a good fight and survive, but just the size of everybody. And Gerard Gordeau, after watching him dismantle, I was like, yeah, I'm probably glad that I'm not in this. I do not have, now I'm the small fish in the big pond, and I knew it. I could see it.
Yeah, when people say that the first few UFCs were with just entirely, you know, like, novices, they're 100% wrong, because those guys were savages, including you. They're just measuring it against a sport that is apples and oranges. It's two different things.
Yeah.
But like I said in the past, Royce could roll out of bed right now and go beat up like 99% of the people that are talking crap.
Yeah.
That everybody in that show could go roll out of bed and beat up 99% of the people that are talking crap. So Royce just so happened to be more familiar with the ground fight, you know.
Well, look at what he did to Ken the last time they fought. You know, for as strong as Ken was, everything Royce did was textbook. You know, Rorion Gracie probably has a book somewhere that had that exact sequence in it. That's and it's only gotten more solid over time. So that's with people who have kept to a core value, it only gets better. It looks the same as it was 20 years ago, 30 years ago, but it's not. And the only way you know is when you feel it. I watched Hickson do a seminar in Japan, and he would say to people, "Are you happy?" And you know, and then you go, "I'm happy by the way he's gripped them." You know, you can't see it from the outside. It looks like he's just grabbing him, but the person working with him knows. Yeah, something's got me, and I don't know what it is. So that's depth. That's layered. It's very layered.
Yeah. So you were at the seminar. Did you take the class from Hickson?
No. I've seen it on YouTube.
Oh, on YouTube.
Yeah, this was recently. This was only a few years ago, I think, that he had done it.
Okay. If you had not gotten to fighting ever, you'd never gotten to fighting, period, what do you think you would be doing or have done with your life?
Unanswerable question. Because all I've been is... Since I was 8 years old, this is really my main focus. That would be a hard question.
Yeah, when your life is built around nothing but fighting, really, as Hoyce's is as well, then fighting is going to be what you were going to do no matter what, right?
Yeah.
So, Roger, do you have any questions for Jason before I do the crazy questions?
Who do you think the, I was just kind of curious, like, your thoughts, like, who would, Who would, like, your top three best fighters of all time be?
That's another hard question.
I know, right?
I mean, I'll say this about that. When you see a guy like Fedor be as dominant as he was for as long as he was, and then you see a guy like Dan Henderson, who I revere, respect, go out there and basically own him in every way, and then you see a guy like, who's the guy who he fought? I'm sorry, it's like quarter past 12. I'm having a...
No. We're cutting it soon here. Is it Chael Sonnen?
No, a black kid. He was champ forever, it seemed. He whipped Dan Henderson off the mat. Wrestler, Division One wrestler.
Not Anderson Silva.
No, Daniel Cormier.
Daniel Cormier.
Yeah. See, I would have never thought. You know, they say, you know, if A equals B, B equals C. Well, so fighter A beats fighter B beats fighter C, but fighter C can't. You know, it just doesn't add up. So I can't pick three. That would be an insult to the top three. That the list of top three would have to be 30 people deep. I wouldn't pick.
Yeah, yeah. Anything else, Roger?
No. I don't want to keep you too long. It's late. Let's end it on a high note.
Okay, so just a few real fast. I'm rolling at you. Please just answer whatever the first thing that comes to your mind is. Ridiculous questions that have nothing to do with fighting, and just some easy, you know, something simple to end on. So if I don't know if you're married still or a girlfriend, what the case is, but if your girlfriend or your wife tells you she wants to watch a chick flick and you absolutely do not want to watch a chick flick, how do you go about getting out of that situation?
I don't really watch TV or movies, so it's not an issue. I think the last movie I saw was like Braveheart.
That's a good answer.
Well, that works too. if you be attacked by a regular sized cat or a regular sized dog, and you don't get to say neither. It's got to be one or the other. But you can choose regular sized cat or regular sized dog. Which is it going to be?
To be attacked by?
To attacked.
You mean I'm going to be attacked by it? Which one would I want?
Yes.
Which one tastes better?
That's a good question. They're probably pretty similar, to be honest with you. Last one. If a zombie apocalypse happened right this second, literally right now while we were talking, it happened, it started, what would your first few moves be?
Not too much. I think I'm the most dangerous animal in these woods.
Good answer. I agree with that too. That's a good answer. Roger, anything else before we go?
Thank you so much for coming on the podcast. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Absolutely. We'll let you in on all the editing.
Send it your way.
Yeah, anything that happens, we'll send it to you first. And before we post anything, we'll send it to you. We'll have a lot different in the final cut. Perhaps the screen will be something entirely different. We might edit together a little bit differently. But either way, we'll send it beforehand.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'm not a computer savvy guy, so if you're going to send anything to this, whatever email I had created today, could you text me and let me know first so that my son is going to do this for me?
Yes. What it'll be is I'll just send you a link to a private video that only you can see, okay. And it'll be YouTube. Okay. So, yeah, it'd be super simple. You just click it and it'll take you right to the video. and you can watch through and make timestamps if you wanted to say like this, maybe change this or that.
Okay.
Let us know whatever the time is, and we can make a change.
Okay.
Other than that, man, yeah, I think that we'll, you know, we'll have a lot to work with.
Oh, yeah.
It might not seem like it, but we do a good job of making this whole thing come together. Yep. So work on that for a few days, and then we'll let you know where it goes.
Thank you guys very much.
Thanks again.
Thank you. Good night, champ. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
About that show.
No, it was entertaining. I just feel like shit, that's all.
You're smelling like shit?
I hope not. No, I just feel like shit.
Man, what are you gonna do? You're gonna have to take some cough medicine or something.
Yeah, I'm just gonna go home, take some medicine, go to bed. Alright, man, I'm about to pull up. I'm gonna run inside, get some medicine, and hit the hay, brother.
Hey, if anybody tries to fight you, then hey, don't avoid the fight.
Yeah. That now's the time they could get me right now. I'd do alright. Just tired and
you have to do the fight. And I say that because then you'll know that your technique works no matter what.
Right.
You think that, and you don't know it, but then you would know it for a fact.
Right. So, if you can fight somebody like that, for sure.
Yeah.
All right, brother.
And you could, but hey, take that medicine and get in that bed.
Oh, yeah. I'm ready. All right, man. I'll let you later.
All righty.